Thank you, Dean George. It's really an honor to be with you today, and wish I could have attended all the sessions. This afternoon is a great honor and a great privilege to introduce to you Dr. Wayne Flynt. Dr. Flynt grew up primarily in Alabama and graduated from Anniston High School. He attended Samford University as a ministerial student with a double major in history and speech, and attended graduate school at the Florida State University, receiving his PhD in American history. Of his 13 books, two deal with Florida politics, three with evangelical religion, three with poverty, and three are broad surveys of Alabama history, including his two most acclaimed, Poor But Proud, Alabama's Poor Whites, and Alabama in the 20th Century. Two of his books have been nominated for the Pulitzer Prize, and one won the Lillian Smith Award for Nonfiction. Two of his books have won the Alabama Library Association Prize for Best Works of Nonfiction, and three times he has won the James Soulsby Book Award for Best Work on Alabama History. Dr. Flynt is a community activist, serving for a decade on the American Cancer Society's Committee for the Socioeconomically Disadvantaged, and was a co-founder of both the Alabama Poverty Project and Sowing Seeds of Hope. He is active in a number of professional organizations, six of which have honored him with their highest awards for service. During his 40-year teaching career at Samford and Auburn University, he won 18 teaching awards, including top teaching honors at both universities. It's with great privilege that I would like for you to welcome and join me in welcoming Dr. Wayne Flynt.
Yesterday, my wife and I drove to Monroeville, Alabama for our monthly visit with Nell Harper Lee. As we opened the door into her apartment at Meadows Assisted Living, I noticed a very big book on her ottoman. The spine of the book was turned in my direction, and I could read the title, The Complete Works of C.S. Lewis. We'd never had a conversation in which the name C.S. Lewis came up. So I said, Nell, I did not know you were a C.S. Lewis fan. Greatest Christian apologist of the 20th century, she said. What's your favorite C.S. Lewis book? I asked Nell. Mere Christianity, the greatest book of Christian apologetics since Augustine. Timothy, I think there are probably a few in between that would qualify, but that's not a bad choice. I said, what else have you read of C.S. Lewis? Just to test her a little. Surprised by Joy, Screwtape Letters, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, on and on and on the list went. And as she talked, I kept thinking of the trajectory of Christian theology one finds in C.S. Lewis. Innocence, temptation, sin, failure, judgment, punishment, confrontation, forgiveness, reconciliation. 13 months ago today, I was returning from Panera Bread after having breakfast with one of my two Sunday school members in the class I teach, turned on the radio to National Public Radio, and Lynn Ehring was announcing the discovery of a new Harper Lee book that was going to be published. I hurried home and told my wife this incredible news just before the phone began to ring. 13 months ago, Saturday, I was in Montgomery with my wife having lunch with, of all people, Nancy Anderson, whom I had commissioned to write the biography of Nell Harper Lee for the Online Encyclopedia of Alabama. If you want a good short biography, that's not a bad place to go. We returned home from Montgomery at 12:30, and when I walked in the door, the phone was ringing. I picked the phone up, and as I put the phone down, it rang again, and as I finished that conversation, it rang again, and I was on the phone from 12:30 until 5:30. When I put the phone down, it rang, and I left anyway to go to church for our prayer meeting. We returned an hour later, and for the next 3 hours, I was on the phone answering 22 phone messages that had been left during the day. I'm not sure of the total number of phone calls that day, but I am sure of both the callers and the hours I spent on the phone. 9 hours on the phone between 12:30 and when I went to bed. In my journal, I have them logged: the London Times, the Sunday Times, the Guardian, the News of the World, London Telegraph, London Independent, Der Spiegel, El País, ABC Radio Australia, Wall Street Journal, New York Times, Reuters, CBS, ABC, NBC, MSNBC, NPR, CNN, NewsHour, Public Television. And the calls did not stop, nor the visit by journalist, for 6 months, from February of 2015 until the book appeared on the 14th of July. The reason for all that excitement, you all know. It was the enormous popularity of one of the great classics in American literature, To Kill a Mockingbird. Appearing in 1960, at a time when American history and current events conditioned us to understand it as a race novel, it won the Pulitzer Prize that year, and from that point on became a true American classic. Between 1895 and 1985, the book was the third best-selling nonfiction in America. It was the seventh best-selling book of any genre, including the Bible, sold in America for that 80 years. It was translated into more than 40 languages, and it has sold more than 40 million copies worldwide. In terms of the popularity of the characters, you of course know the movie and the book are almost inseparable in the world consciousness. The American Academy of Cinema judged Atticus Finch to be the greatest hero of American cinema in the 20th century. The book has morphed from a book about race to a book about tolerance. It is essentially understood in Australia and in China and in many other parts of the world as a book that suggests that we cannot judge another person until we get inside their skin and walk in their shoes. Therefore, when the journalist called over the 6 months between February and July of 2015, the almost universal question I anticipated somewhere in the conversation was, do you know what the book is about? And I said, I have a hunch I know what it's about. And they said, have you read the book? And I said, no, I have not read the book because the book is quarantined. So no one has read the book. The reporters asked the logical question, you have a hunch, you know what the book is about, but you have not read the book. And I could almost hear the assumption of clairvoyance in the interviewee. So I said, no, I I don't know what the book is about in the sense that I have read it, only in the sense that I have written 9 books about Alabama, mostly in the 20th century, and it would be hard to have written 9 books about Alabama, mostly in the 20th century, and not have a hunch I know what the book is about. I did not say what I was thinking. I've not only read the book, not really read the book, but written 9 books about what the book is about, I've actually lived the book. It's an old book, certainly as old as the Bible. What was happening in Alabama between 1949, when Nell, at the age of 23, left Monroeville and moved to New York City, and despite frequent journalistic references to splitting her time living in Alabama and New York City, which is in fact not true, she never again lived in Alabama. She visited her 2 sisters, her brother, cared for her father when he was dying in Monroeville. She never lived again in Alabama. Home was New York. It was not Alabama. And so, this is what happened in Alabama. 1954, Brown v. Board. 1955, implementation of Brown v. Board. December 1955, the beginning of the Montgomery bus boycott, which lasted until December of 1956. African-American pregnant female shot by sniper on a Montgomery bus. 4 African-American churches in Montgomery dynamited by white terrorists between the beginning of the bus boycott and its end. The home of Martin Luther King bombed during the Montgomery bus boycott. In Birmingham, 33 racial bombings between 1949 and 1963. An African-American male walking along a road in Jefferson County, kidnapped by white terrorists and castrated for no reason whatever, except he happened to be at the wrong place at the wrong time. The rise of the White Citizens Councils, which had 80,000 members by 1956 and controlled city councils and county governments across the state of Alabama. The most prominent and respected lawyer in the state, who edited the Alabama Lawyer and turned that journal into a tactical manual for massive resistance. In 1956, in the session of the Alabama legislature, the Boutwell Amendment passed by a vote of 98-1. The Boutwell Amendment closed Alabama public schools for every single student rather than integrate them. Yes, I had some idea, some hunch, that I knew what Nell Harper Lee, who left Monroeville to go to New York City and read the New York Times almost every day, and must have gone to parties with her friend Truman Capote in which people said, "And where are you from, Nell?" "Alabama." "Oh, I am so sorry." When the book appeared on the 14th of July, 2015, I discovered my hunch had been right. And a great many fans of Atticus and Nell Harper and To Kill a Mockingbird discovered a very different Atticus Finch. Not the hero we loved, who faced down the mob and his community, as in her recast 2nd novel, To Kill a Mockingbird, but as an accommodationist segregationist who in real life wrote editorials for the town newspaper in which he defended segregation, and according at least to the Methodist minister who was the object of this incident, was fired as pastor of the Methodist Church in Monroeville, largely by its most famous practitioner, Coley Lee, Nell's father, for his liberal views on race. a claim, I might add, that Nell and her sisters denied to their deaths. In January of 1957, Harper Lee submitted Go Set a Watchman to her agent, Maurice Crane, and to her editor at Lippincott, Tay Hohoff. They explain, the characterizations were wonderful, but America was not ready for this novel. However, the characterizations of the three children, Jim, Dill, and Scout, and the recluse, Boo Radley, were brilliant. Why not just reset the story to 1932 to 1935, when Scout was not 26, as in the first draft of Go Set a Watchman, but 6. Where the father was not flawed, but perfect. When local blacks were not those pushing, not militant. When in Monroeville, blacks still knew their place. And in 1932 to 1935, where Southerners, Democrats, racists controlled all the key committees of the House and the United States Senate and made sure the New Deal and Franklin Roosevelt would not stray beyond the boundaries of Southern racism, despite the opinions of Roosevelt's wife, Eleanor. And when the Supreme Court had essentially, for half a century, succumbed to Southern racism, beginning with Plessy v. Ferguson and lasting right to Brown v. Board. As a result of what Maurice Crane and Tay Hohoff told her in January of 1957, she set about rewriting the novel, as they had suggested. And what was intended to be her first novel was published in July 2015, and the novel that was not proper for her times was published in July 2015. No matter how you feel about race, you're not going to like what I'm going to read. Because if Atticus is still your hero, I'm about to dismantle him in the words of his daughter. And if you think Jean Louise Finch is your hero, perhaps, maybe by a stretch, a hero by Alabama standards in 1956, but certainly not the standards of New York City in 1956. And she is so hopelessly a gradualist by the standards of 2016 that I should hardly bother with her. Remember C.S. Lewis's progression? Innocence, temptation, sin, judgment, confrontation, forgiveness, reconciliation. Here is the father in the mind of the beloved daughter before she understood who her father really was. Integrity, honor, and patience were the three words for Atticus Finch. There was also a phrase for him. Pick at random any citizen from Macon County and its environs. Ask him what he thought of Atticus Finch, and the answer would most likely be, I never had a better friend. Atticus Finch's secret of living was so simple, it was deeply complex. Where most men had codes and tried to live up to them, Atticus lived his to the letter and with no fuss. No fanfare and no soul searching. His private character was also his public character. His code was simple New Testament ethic. Its rewards were the respect and devotion of all who knew him. Even his enemies loved him because Atticus never acknowledged they were his enemies. He was never a rich man, but he was the richest man his children ever knew. What stood behind her, the most potent moral force in her life, was the love of her father. She never questioned it, never thought about it, never even realized that before she made any decision of importance, the reflex, "What would Atticus do?" passed through her unconscious. She never realized that what made her dig in her feet and stand firm whenever she did was her father. That whatever was decent and of good report in her character was put there by her father. She did not know that she worshiped him. One day after arriving back in Macon, Scout hears there's going to be a meeting, and Scout Jean Louise decides to go to the meeting. Now 26 years old, she sits in the balcony where the blacks sat in the trial of Tom Robinson in the second novel, To Kill a Mockingbird. But this time, she's watching all the white people, including her father and her fiancé, organize the Macon County chapter of the White Citizens Council. And as she listens, everything changes. Remember in C.S. Lewis, the confrontation. I heard something once. I heard a slogan and it stuck in my head. I heard, "Equal rights for all and special privileges for none." And to me, it didn't mean anything but what it said. It didn't mean one card off the top of the stack for the white man and another stack off the bottom of the card for the Negro. It, "Let's look at it this way," said her father. "You realize our Negro population is backward, don't you? You will concede that. You realize the full implication of the word backward, Scout?" "Yes, sir." Think this over. Abbott County across the river is in bad trouble. The population is almost three-fourths Negro. The voting population is almost half and half now because of that big normal school over there. If the scales were tipped over, what would you have? The county won't keep a full board of registrars operating because if the Negro vote edged out the white, you'd have Negroes in every elected office. Jean Louise, I'm trying to tell you some plain truths. You must see things as they are, not as what they should be." "Then why didn't you show me things as they are when I sat in your lap? Why didn't you show me? Why weren't you careful when you read me history and the things that I thought meant something to you, that there was a fence around everything marked white only?" "Then let's put this on a practical basis, Scout. Do you want Negroes by the carload in our schools and churches and theaters? Do you want them in our world? They're people, aren't they? We were quite willing to import them when they made money for us. Do you want your children going to school that's been dragged down to accommodate Negro children? The scholastic level of that school down the street, Atticus, couldn't be any lower, and you know it. They're entitled to the same opportunities anyone else has. They're entitled to the same chance. Honey, you just don't understand that the Negroes down here are still in their childhood as a people. You should know it, You've seen it all your life. They've made tremendous progress in accommodating themselves to white ways, but they're far from it yet. They were coming along fine, traveling at a rate they could absorb, more of them voting than ever before. Then the NAACP stepped in with its fantastical demands and shoddy ideas of government. Can you blame the South for resenting being told what to do about its own people by people who have no idea of our daily problems? How can you have grown up here, Jean Louise, led the kind of life you've led, and can only see something stomping on the 10th Amendment? Jean Louise, they're trying to wreck us. Where have you been? I've been right here in Macomb. What do you mean? I mean, I grew up here in this house, and I never knew what was in your mind. I only heard what you said. You neglected to tell me that we were naturally better than the Negroes, bless their kinky heads, that they were able to go so far, but only so far. You neglected to tell me what Mr. Hanlon said at the White Citizens Council meeting yesterday. That was you talking down there, but you let O'Hanlon say it for you. You're a coward, Atticus, as well as a snob and a tyrant. When you talked of justice, you forgot to say that justice is something that had nothing to do with real people. I remember that rape case you defended, but I missed the whole point. You love justice, all right. Abstract justice, written down item by item on your brief, nothing to do with that black boy. You just like a neat brief. His cause interfered with your orderly mind, and you had to work it out, all order out of disorder. It's a compulsion with you. And now it's coming home to you. She was now on her feet, holding the back of a chair. Atticus, I'm throwing this at you, and I'm going to grind it in. You'd better go warn your younger friends that if they want to preserve our way of life down here, it all begins at home. It doesn't begin with the schools. It doesn't begin with the churches or any place but home. Tell them that, and use your blind, immoral, misguided, nigger-loving daughter as your example. Go in front of me with a bell and say, unclean, unclean. Point out me as your mistake. Point me out, Jean Louise Finch, who was exposed to all kinds of guff from the white trash I went to school with. But she never should have gone to school at all for all the influence on her, because everything that was gospel to her, she got at home from her father. You sowed the seeds in me, Atticus, and now it's coming home to you. Are you finished with what you have to say? She sneered. Not half through yet. I'll never forgive you for what you did to me. You cheated me. You've driven me out of my home, and now I'm in a no man's land but good. There's no place for me anymore in Macomb, but I'll never be entirely home anywhere else. God. And speaking of God, why didn't you make it very plain to me that God made the races and put the black folks in Africa with the intention of keeping them there so the missionaries could go tell them that Jesus loved them, but meant for them to stay in Africa? That us bringing them over here was all a bad mistake. They're to blame. that Jesus loved all mankind, but there are different kinds of men with separate fences around them. That Jesus meant that any man can go as far as he wants within his fence. Jean Louise, come down to earth. All right, I'll come down to earth. I'll land right in our living room of our house. I'll come right down to you. I believed in you. I looked up to you. Atticus, I looked up to you like I never looked up to anybody in my life and never will again. If you had only given me some hint, if you had only broken your word with me a couple of times, if you had been bad-tempered or impatient with me, if you had been a lesser man, maybe I could have taken what I was doing. If once or twice you'd let me catch you doing something vile, then I would have understood what you did yesterday. Then I've said, that's just his way. That's just my old man, because I'd have been prepared for it somewhere along the line. But you deny them hope. Any man in this world, Atticus, any man who has a head and arms and legs was born with hope in his heart. You won't find that in the Constitution I picked up at church one time. They're simple people, most of them, but they're not subhuman. You were telling them that Jesus loves them, but not very much. You were using frightful means to justify ends that you think are for the good of most people. Your ends may be right, but you cannot use people as pawns. Atticus, you simply cannot. There was no point in saying any of this, because I know you will not give an inch. You've cheated me in a way that's inexpressible, but don't let it worry you, because the joke is entirely on me. You're the only person I think I've ever fully trusted, and now I'm done for. I've killed you, Scout, because I had to. Don't you give me any more of this double talk. You're a nice, sweet old gentleman, and I'll never believe a word you say to me again. I despise you and everything you stand for. Well, I love you. Don't you dare say that to me. Love me, Atticus? I'm getting out of this place fast. I don't know where I'm going, but I'm going. I never want to see another Finch or hear of one as long as I live. As you please. You double-speaking, ring-tailed old son of a bitch. You just sit there and say, as you please, when you've knocked me down and stomped on me and spat on me. You just sit there and say, as you please. When everything I ever loved in this world, you just sit there and say, as you please, you love me, you old son of a bitch. That'll do, Jean Louise. That'll do. His general call to order in the days when I still believed. So he kills me and gives it a twist. How can he taunt me so? How can he treat me so? God in heaven, take me away from here. God in heaven, take me away. Well, how do you feel about Scout now? And how do you feel about Atticus now that the confrontation is over? Well, I told you I had a hunch I knew what the book was about, because the same year she finished what was really Ghost Had a Watchman, in January of 1957, I had some conversations with my father in Anniston, Alabama. I was age 16 when the conversations began, and the first conversation was about a missionary from our church, Christy Poole, a missionary to Ogbomosho, Africa, and our church, unusual among Baptist churches, paid the entire salary of these two missionaries. In Ogbomosho, at the Baptist missionary, he taught a whole generation of Nigerian Baptist ministers theology, and many were converted in Ogbomosho from his preaching. In fact, I now teach three members of my Sunday school class, two of whom were born in Ogbomosho, born to Baptist families, which may have, in fact, been the converts of Christy Poole and his wife. I have another one, Ben Oni, from Southern Nigeria, an aerospace engineer at Tuskegee Institute, who's also a member of that same class. Ben might have been the end product, the shadow of Christy Poole himself. The conversation that we had went something like this: Dad, how is it that Christy Poole can have his salary paid by our church to go to Ogbomosho and make converts who then cannot attend our church if they come to Anniston? It's just tradition, Wayne. You're not old enough to understand. I think I am, Dad. I've read the Bible. I've gone to Ridgecrest Baptist Assembly. I've heard the great Baptist ethicist T.B. Maston, who wrote the Bible in race, and nothing I hear there in the Bible and from him corresponds with a racial pattern of Southern evangelicalism. So explain it to me. It's just tradition, Wayne. It's the way it's always been. Well, it's not the way of Jesus. My father was not an evil man. So far as I know, he never joined the Klan. He was not a member of the White Citizens Council. He was from North Alabama and didn't like South Alabama politicians, so I doubt that he even voted for George C. Wallace. However, I do know his racial views, and I do know that when, after I graduated college in May of 1961 and returned home just after Mother's Day, when Ku Klux Klansmen from my hometown firebombed the first load of Freedom Riders to come south, and if it had not been for a courageous Alabama state trooper, would have no doubt emulated the entire busload of them. And then when I became minister of youth at my home church, Parker Memorial, and tried to explain all this to a new generation of young people, and my dad decided that my real problem was that I had become engaged to a woman who was herself the daughter of a Southern Baptist minister from Alabama who had slipped the bonds of race a generation before me. My dad blamed her and her father because he could never really get it through his mind that I could have escaped the bonds of my culture just by reading the Bible. So when I read Go Set a Watchman, I saw myself in the self-righteous words of Jean Louise. The judgmentalism that Jean Louise expressed and that you just heard was the judgmentalism I used about my father. Never really aware that he was 30 years older than I was, and that Dad was as much a part of his racist culture as I was becoming a product of my more enlightened culture. I was, like Jean Louise in 1956, not an enlightened racial liberal, but in fact a gradualist who felt the Supreme Court had gone too far and too fast. The South just needed a little more time. Religious people would rally like the people at Parker Memorial. They would never bomb a bus. They would never throw a Molotov cocktail into a bus full of human beings. In retrospect, more time would not have made the South any different. We would have rationalized Southern culture into the Bible and into our churches, just as we did when we defended slavery and apartheid. Congregationally employed ministers, however enlightened they were, would mostly cower and remain silent. Easy for me to brand them as a young professor in 1965 at this very college, my alma mater. When I returned, the very month the Voting Rights Act was signed by Lyndon Johnson, and organized the first voter registration drive in the Rosedale community, and carried black voters to the polls for the first time in 1966 and 1968, and organized a tutoring program at Rosedale High School, which resulted in the first black co-ed who attended this college in 1969. Easy enough for me, I was a college professor and largely immune from the pressures that would have resulted in the firing of all my fellow ministerial students from 1958 to 1961 had they done in 1965 what I did. Although my vocabulary was not quite as colorful as Jean Louise's or as varied, when she exploded to her uncle, her aunt, and her father in Go Set a Watchman, my attitude was pretty much the same kind of judgmental attitude that she had. Nor do I for one moment standing before you bemoan or regret or take back one word I said to my dad. Just as Nell went to her grave, not taking back one word she said in Go Set a Watchman. As Ecclesiastes make clear, there is a time to speak and a time to be silent. White Southern evangelicals achieved a PhD in the art of silence. We didn't do so well with the speak up. Our tongues got buried in our cheeks. We could have waited a year or 10 years or 100 years, and justice would not have flown down like a river until African Americans made it happen. So, millions of our young people did what Nell Harper Lee did, departed home for a new home, Macon for New York City. Perhaps home is a sanctuary down here in Alabama, a sanctuary if you're not different, if you're not other, if you're not outsider, if you're not troublemaker. But if you're any of those things, well, home is not so much home. And here we are, 55 years after the first novel, Go Set a Watchman, which her editor and her agent judged too far ahead of America to be published. And now it's been published. And frankly, I'm not sure America is ready for Go Set a Watchman either. I suppose we'll see, won't we? About the same time Nell finished writing Go Set a Watchman, North Carolina Jewish journalist, activist, humorist Harry Golden wrote in his newspaper, The North Carolina Israelite, "No state can long progress which exiles its prophets and exalts its fools." I think Birmingham understands that. Charleston, Atlanta, Tampa, Montgomery, Mobile. I'm not so sure any of the states in which they exist understand that. And so I've told you three conversations. The conversation Nell had with her father about his racist editorials. The conversation Jean Louise had with her father, Atticus, about Monroeville in 1956. The conversation I had with my father. One more conversation. God in heaven, take me away from here. God in heaven, take me away. And God did. God did. In this case, millions of our children think of all the people you know whose children now live in New York, Los Angeles, Chicago. In my case, it's Seattle, where my son, daughter, and two grandchildren live. 3 or 4 years ago, I said, David, I know you have a very good job as vice president for a software company in Seattle, but we're getting old. And besides that, there are a lot of good companies in the South. Dad, we're not coming back to the South to live. David, there are great software companies in Huntsville, in Charleston, in Savannah, all sorts of interesting cities. You don't have to come back to Alabama, but there are a lot of places to come back to in the South. Dad, we're not coming back to the South. I said, David, you know, we're getting old. He said, Dad, we're not coming back to the South. We don't want our children educated in the South. We don't want them to go to schools in the South. We don't want to be in a state where the Chief Justice of the state Supreme Court is Roy Moore. We are not coming back to the South. Fourth conversation. So, Nell Harper Lee left a legacy. Legacy pretty relevant to the conversation we've had today. Thank you very much.
I believe we have time for just a few questions, so if anyone has a question, if you would raise your hand, and I believe we have people with microphones. Any questions? Okay, I don't see any questions. One question right up here.
Of the review of Go Set a Watchman, and of course, the classic, To Kill a Mockingbird, come when it has come for this conference. When Bishop Baker, when we were talking in the process of planning, the discussion of the book Go Set a Watchman came up, and I had read it, because I was curious about it, and it was raw. And I said then, I just don't think that it would be ready for now. But this parallels very well with what Archbishop Braxton had said with what the police chief. It just parallels very well that Alabama is our home, and unless we do something about it, it's not my home, I went to school here, but unless we do something about it, and unless we decide that we can change the racist and the racism divide by, as the Archbishop said in the end of his five or six petitions act, it will never. And it all comes out in this book. I'm not trying to help sell our book. But if you haven't, I'm so sorry I didn't bring mine, sir, so that you could have assigned it to. But it is worth reading, and I thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I couldn't agree with you more. It's interesting the way in which all literature is born into a time. It's published into a time. And sometimes you write a book that really speaks to you as a writer and to the times that you come from, only to discover it doesn't speak to much of anybody else. In the case of To Kill a Mockingbird, clearly one of the reason for its great popularity was understood as a race book at the very cuspis of this great civil rights movement of the 1960s. However, when I was on ABC Radio Australia, they don't perceive they have a race problem. They perceive they have an ethnic problem, and there's the Aborigines, but they don't understand that this is a race problem. To them, the takeaway is tolerance. And I would argue that one reason the book has sold 40 million copies around the world is because tolerance is such an issue everywhere in the world, not just here in America. By the same token, I really think that over time, well, obviously what happened in Charleston conditioned American reflexively to understand Go Set a Watchman as a race book. I really don't think it is. I think it is a book about race, but I think the takeaway is the C.S. Lewis story of the human trajectory. I think Neil is a really good theologian. Maybe with a vocabulary a little richer that theologians would like to have sometimes, but probably don't use. But I do believe, as one of her sisters referred to her father, he was an inner Christian. And I said, I don't know what you mean by that, Louise. I've never heard the term. She said, I mean, he was never ostentatious. He never asked people, were they Christian? He just lived out the ethic of Christ in his life, obviously, incompletely, as we all do. And so I think that over time, this will be understood by every young person who ever had a conversation with any parent at that point where innocence has been lost about the parent. Oscar Wilde put it this way: in the beginning, we all think our parents are innocent. In time, we come to judge them. Almost never do we learn to forgive them. Powerful line, powerful line. And I really think that forgiveness part is where we're going to have to get in America over race. And I don't think we're going to get to forgiveness and reconciliation until we have the conversation. And we didn't have it in the 60s. We shouted at each other, but we did not confront each other. And what I'm hoping is going to happen is that, as so many speakers have already said, we're in a moment where we really need to be honest and have that confrontation. You know, silence won't do anymore. I mean, what do you make out of a world in which the leading contender for the presidency of the United States is a man who calls himself a Christian and who does believe in the Trinity, narcissism, hedonism, and materialism, a man who is endorsed by more than half of the evangelicals who have been polled when they came out of the polling booths, and a man who is a parody of every Christian value I know, a man who is not what Christ was, is, or ever will be. And he does best among white evangelicals in the South. I don't know about you, but I've just dropped the term evangelical from who I am. I'll just take Christian and stay with that, because I don't understand my fellow Southern white Christians anymore.
Well, thank you, Wayne. It's been a very thoughtful and marvelous speech. Thank you, and I think we have a break.